Hi, I'm Annie Dance. Please subscribe to anniedance.substack.com for Lake Lure area news on policy and police issues in Western North Carolina. Tomorrow, Tuesday, March 5th, is primary election day. You can learn more about who is on the ballot by looking at my past reporting on my website, anniedance.substack.com, and I'm going to share with you now what the state board elections had to say, including questions I raised about photographing your ballot and the legalities associated with that.
Before we get started, I do want to thank our interpreters who are with us from the American Sign Language and from our Spanish language interpreters for being with us today. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the day before 2024 primary election day. I'm Karen Brinson Bell, Executive Director of the State Board of Elections. I'm here with Paul Cox, General Counsel to the State Board. I'm going to give some brief introductory remarks, and then we will take questions, both remotely and here in person. The past 3 months have gone by very quickly as we have held candidate filing in December, then moved right into absentee by mail voting in January, all leading us to North Carolina's 2024 presidential preference primary tomorrow. A very successful in-person early voting period ended this past Saturday. Statewide, more than 670,000 voters cast ballots during the early voting period, and 19,449 voters have cast ballots by mail. So between in-person early voting and absentee voting combined, we are below turnout for the presidential primary in 2020. That all said, I want to provide a few reminders about Election Day that I hope you will all share with your audiences. First, remember this is a primary election. Primaries are elections used to determine each political party's nominees who will advance to the general election in November. In a partisan primary, voters affiliated with a political party may only vote their party's ballot and may not vote in another party's primary. Unaffiliated voters may choose any one political party's ballot or a nonpartisan ballot if available in their jurisdiction. There are Democratic, Republican, and Libertarian primaries in our state this year. An unaffiliated voter may choose to participate in one of these party primaries, while a voter who is registered as a Democrat, Republican, or Libertarian will receive the party's ballot with which they are affiliated. Second, you must go to your assigned polling place on Election Day. Nearly 2,600 polling places will be open from 6:30 a.m. to 7:30 p.m. across North Carolina. Voters should use the voter search tool on the State Board's website, ncsbe.gov, to find their polling place and their sample ballot or ballots. Third, bring your photo ID. You will be asked to show photo ID at your polling place when you check in to vote. Most voters will simply show their driver's license, but there are many other acceptable photo IDs. For more information, including the full list of acceptable IDs, visit bringitnc.com. If a voter cannot show a photo ID, they can still vote by filling out an ID exception form and voting a provisional ballot. Fourth, if you still plan to vote an absentee ballot, tomorrow is the deadline to get that ballot into your county board office. So at this point, do not put that ballot in the mail. It likely will not arrive before the deadline at 7:30 p.m. tomorrow. You can instead drop it off at your county board of elections office, whether today during business hours or tomorrow before 7:30 p.m. Or you can simply discard your absentee ballot and vote in person at your assigned polling place on Election Day tomorrow. And finally, I want to express gratitude for all the election workers who will be waking up early and staying up late tomorrow. Thousands of election workers across the state have prepared and trained to serve the voters. We strongly encourage all eligible voters who haven't cast a ballot to show up tomorrow and make your voice heard. And while you're at it, thank your local poll workers for their service to your community. We ask that all who participate tomorrow, voters, poll workers, observers, and campaigners, treat each other with dignity and respect. We know the political climate in our country is tense, but let's make North Carolina a model for accessible, safe, secure, and accurate elections. And with that, we welcome your questions. We'll start here in the room, and then we'll go to anyone remotely. Yes, Laura.
Can you explain, please, what changes were made by the law that is going to make the vote count come out a little later tomorrow night?
Yes. So Laura's question is referencing that the legislature in Senate Bill 747, with the passage of that bill, which was about 65 pages long and had many changes to North Carolina's elections processes. One of those is the release of the early voting results. For many years, we have released those early voting results with absentee by mail results at the close of polls. Starting tomorrow, we will release absentee by mail results when the polls close. However, the change in the law requires that we not tabulate the early voting results until after the polls close. So with that, all the counties will tabulate the early voting results after 7:30 p.m. and then begin the upload process as they are able while they are also processing election day results. So this may mean a delay in those early voting results, those 670,000 ballots that have been cast thus far. We will not see those results posted to our website until after 7:30 p.m. So for some, it may be 30 minutes. For other counties that have multiple early voting sites, it may be an hour to 2 hours before we see those posted. And they'll be releasing those results as they are releasing election day results as those come in as well.
Michael Hyland from CBS 17. Back during the municipal elections, you all gave us some data then about people who cast provisional ballots because they couldn't comply with the voter ID law when they showed up in person. Do you have any numbers for what we've seen so far during early voting in the primary about how many people might have been impacted by that?
Neither Paul nor I can have seen those numbers at this point. There has been a slight change to where the counties are going to be providing the number of provisional ballots cast on Wednesday rather than Thursday, but that will obviously include the election day provisional ballots as well.
Thank you.
The provisional ballots, that tally, as well as ultimately the ones that we count and the results of those, will be provided after the election as part of the certification process.
I know you mentioned treating everyone with respect. How are you guys working to handle any voter harassment and intimidation at those polling locations? We know we've seen this in the past.
We are always mindful that our primary goal is to make certain that any eligible voter is able to cast their ballot, exercise their right to vote. And so in doing so, we have provided information to the political parties, to our election workers, to the public through our numbered memo about the observer rules, about conduct at the polls, so how campaigners are what they're subject to, the buffer zone where no one can enter that space other than someone coming into the voting enclosure. The only folks allowed in the voting enclosure are those who are election officials, the voters. And then, of course, the media can be invited in and a few others. But we work to make sure that folks understand what the rules and the procedures are. We in North Carolina do not allow for law enforcement to be stationed at polling places because that could be intimidating to a voter. And they partner with us to understand what election laws allow for and how they can, if need be called in as peacekeepers to help us mitigate a situation. Hopefully it does not come to that. We've really had pretty calm early voting. And what few instances have happened have been very one-off situations. And so hopefully tomorrow will be no different. And we will continue to just be mindful of that fine line between free speech and voter intimidation and keeping peace at the polls. We also have a couple of years ago, we produced the guide for law enforcement officials so that they understand election laws. So if they are called to a polling place, they can help us in enforcing those rules and laws that may actually be a misdemeanor or a felony to disrupt a polling place or create an issue at a polling place. So we have maintained that material for them that is available for the public on our website, ncsbe.gov, as well. Paula, is there anything else you want to add?
It's an important question. At the state board, we've really worked hard to make sure that our county boards of elections know and that their poll workers who they're training know the rules of the road. And one of the important rules of the road is that the chief judge, who is the chief election official responsible for voting at each voting site, has the responsibility to maintain peace and order. And if any voter is being interfered with, being intimidated, the voter should contact that chief judge, let that chief judge or any other poll worker know, hey, something's going on, and they can try to remedy that situation. If it comes to it, of course, they have the ability to call law enforcement. And then, of course, we want to know about situations like that, too. And we are in constant contact with our counties and with advocates who are out there to help protect the vote if there are situations like that.
About poll observers. Can you talk about how the rules have changed this year and what you might see a partisan poll observer do or not do that's legal for them to do as you're in there in the voting enclosure?
I'll start and then I'll let Paul answer that question as well. So there have been some changes to the poll observer laws, even though observers have been a part of our political process in North Carolina for decades. In many ways, we see this as clarification to what the law allows. There will be some changes. There have been some changes in when the political parties can notify us of these observers. They also will be wearing an ID, a badge that will identify them as an observer so that it's clear to the voter that that person is there in an observer capacity. And if they need assistance, they should be working with their precinct officials to have assistance in the polling place. It does, the observer laws have allowed for the observers to move about the polling place more than what they have been able to in the past, though we still have some parameters around that, because if moving about means that they could view how a voter has cast their ballot, then, or is marking their ballot, then they will not be able to, enter into that close of proximity. The secrecy of the ballot will still be the most important thing for us in the polling places, be that while they're in their voting booth or be that while they're putting that ballot into the tabulator. Paul, are there other aspects you want to touch on? Okay.
You mentioned there were some instances during early voting, maybe some one-offs. What were those examples and what locations?
I don't know them all. We do gather incident reports from the counties when there's something. The one that I became familiar with at the end of last week, there was a disagreement between two campaigners at a early voting site. I believe it was in Mount Holly. I know it was in Gaston County, but nothing significant. They were able to mitigate the situation before we even knew about the incident.
Hi, Kyle Ingram with the News and Observer. Could you go over under what circumstances the deadline could be extended to some polling places and what the process is for doing that?
Yes, that's a very good question. So there are times when voting may be delayed or a disruption in voting occurs such that if that goes beyond 15 minutes, then the state board may convene and they can vote to extend voting for the for those that time period that it was disrupted. A disruption may be something relatively simple. Perhaps the custodian didn't meet the workers at the polling site on time in order to get the voting site open. Knock on wood, that won't be anything that keeps us from opening the polls. There are ways we can have someone even vote from the hood of their car if necessary. That could be something like that that would delay things. The other could be if something occurs during election day where these are buildings. There could be the smell of gas, and they might have to evacuate the building to determine whether there's an actual gas leak or something of that nature. We've seen that before. So we'll take, all the considerations of, how many people were in line, how many individuals may have left because of the delay. Things of that nature are usually the questions that the state board asks in helping them also to determine whether to change the or extend the voting time. Paul, is there anything? Okay. Are there any remote questions that need to be answered? I'm giving it just a moment because we've had a few technical glitches this morning. Pat's going to double check, make sure we don't have anything. Is that Brian?
Yes, when the reporter is on the line, please press 1 to ask a question.
All right. Well,
we have Barry Robertson with the Associated Press. Please go ahead, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, Gary. Hi.
Hi, Karen. I just wanted to follow up on what Kyle asked. Did anything in Senate Bill 747 change that process to delay the end of voting? Because I feel like there was some provision that was related to that if it was shut down in one, if it was delayed in one precinct, then all precincts would remain open, or am I making that up?
Yeah, I was just confirming with Paul. There were some changes in early drafts of the bill, but ultimately not in the final draft that was passed.
All right, thank you.
Our next question is from Annie Tan. Annie, please announce who you're with. I can't seem to find it here on the list.
This is Annie Gantz. I have a Substack newsletter called Cops in Congress, AnnieGantz.substack.com. Can you clarify when voters are allowed to use photography and video at the polls and what circumstance ballot selfies are not allowed, but when can they actually take photographs? Thanks.
Annie, I'm going to let Paul answer that question since there are some possible crimes associated with that.
Yeah, so the question was about whether, when and whether voters can use their phone as a camera in the voting place. As a general matter, voters should never be taking out their phones and taking pictures, taking videos, or even audio recording in the voting place. If you take a picture of your voted ballot, it actually is a crime under North Carolina law. So we highly discourage any voters from doing that. This includes absentee voters. So if you're at your home and you're casting your ballot, about to send it in the mail, you should not be taking a selfie with your voted ballot in that regard either. There is an exception if the voter and the chief judge agree that the voter can have their picture taken in the voting place. It has to be nowhere near any voted ballots. That's a very minor exception, and it's one that the media uses sometimes when they need to get footage of inside the voting place. But as a general matter, voters should not be using their phone or any other device to take pictures or video in the voting site.
And just, along those lines, we do, however, encourage folks to, do those selfies outside of the voting site. A lot of the counties have established backdrops or signs that people can use for selfie purposes, because, you know, it is encouraging to others when they know that their friends and neighbors have voted and hopefully will participate in the process as well. Are there any other questions from online?
Next question is from Brian Anderson with Anderson Alerts. Brian, are you there? Hear me okay?
I can hear you, Brian.
Yeah. Oh, perfect. Thank you, guys. I had a question on just the process of reporting of these early votes. I know you guys have said that it'll take an estimated 30 to 60 minutes, but this can possibly be longer in some counties. Can you just explain what those some counties might be? And I assume we're talking about more heavily populated areas.
Actually, we don't know what to expect exactly, and it may not be that the early voting results are delayed in larger counties versus smaller counties. I think what we need to keep in mind is how this process works. In election offices, a small county, for example, has very little staff. And so those individuals are wearing multiple hats. They are taking the calls from the public. They are taking the calls from the polling places that may be, you know, looking for that closeout checklist or have some procedure that they need clarification on, while they're also trying to work with the board members to get those early voting results tabulated. So even a small county may be delayed because they're trying to, you know, keep all the plates spinning at the same time. So we're just going to ask for patience with them. The larger counties, we're anticipating that it may take them a little longer simply because the large counties have 10, 15 early voting sites, and just the time that it takes to close down to tabulate and close down those machines, to export the results and upload those into our system, and to, you know, verify the accuracy of those before they are published to the public. Those are steps that have to be taken, and they just may take some time. With election day results, whether they're early voting results, absentee results, or election day, or even the results that we work through during the certification period, our goal is to be as expedient as possible, but the primary objective is to be accurate. And so, you know, folks need to recognize that even without this change, you know, election day results are not going to be posted until probably 8:30, maybe the earliest, pushing 9 o'clock for most people, because all of our election results are brought in from the polling places into the election office, the election headquarters, and then they're uploaded. So we have to allow for drive time. We have to allow for the shutdown time and those things to take place before we're ever even able to post election day results. Other questions?
Kyle, do you want to get to the line?
Yes, please, online. There are no more questions online. Okay, thanks, Brian. Kyle, did you have a question?
Yeah, I just want to ask, I know there's some crowded primaries, like the Republican one for lieutenant governor. Could you just explain briefly how the runoff process would work?
Yes. In North Carolina, we have a system where we could have a second primary or a runoff to our primary elections. And if a candidate does not receive 30% plus one of the vote, then the second place finisher can call for a second primary or runoff to the primary. And we have several contests across the state, some at the local level, we won't get into individually, but more prominent are, we have a lot of candidates in several of the congressional seats. And we also have a large number of candidates, in particular with the Republican lieutenant governor race. So we will all be watching to see if these candidates are able to cross that threshold of 30% plus one. If we do have a second primary, I will just note, if Sorry. If we do have a second primary, I will note that that date would be May the 14th. There was a point in time when we had two possible dates in North Carolina. Changes in election law have remedied that, and it will be held no matter what contest. If we have a second primary, it would be 10 weeks after Election Day. So that would be Tuesday, May the 14th. So there was a follow-up online. Ready for that?
Ready for that.
Anderson here, just confirming, can you hear me okay there?
Yes, I can.
Perfect. I just had a campaign finance question. I've looked at some of the filings and have seen transactions to candidates that exceed the $6,400 limit. And I'm just curious, is there a way candidates can distinguish a contribution if someone is claiming a contribution came from a couple? So in other words, I've seen some line items of $12,800. Is that legal if it comes from a couple? And what would be the recommendation to candidates if they get a donation that exceeds that $6,400 limit?
We don't get many campaign finance questions during these press availabilities. So thank you for asking that. Let's keep in mind that there are reporting deadlines, and so the candidates and the campaign committees have submitted their report. Our audit or review for compliance on those takes a period of time. So we will be looking for any violations of campaign finance contribution levels. We will work with the committees. Sometimes you can even find further down into those reports where they have recognized where there's been someone who's exceeded the threshold or the contribution limits, or perhaps made a cash contribution over the amount that's permitted, something along those lines, and they will self-correct and show that further into the report. We are able to work with committees in their reporting when it's couples, but it is still individual contributions, and so we work through that as well with those committees. So without knowing the exact situation or having that in front of me, I think that's probably the best I can describe how the campaign finance reporting process works. All right. Well, I hope all of you get a good night's sleep, just like our workers, because it's going to be a long day for you tomorrow, too. Thank you for coming out today, and we will be with you, I believe, tomorrow. We anticipate doing another media availability just to let you know how the opening of polls glow and be ready for anything else that might come with this 2024 presidential preference primary. So thank you for your time, and have a great day.